नाउ आवर नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज 12.3 एटॉमिक स्पेक्ट्रा। नाउ स्टूडेंट्स, इफ अ गैस और अ वेपर इज एक्साइटेड एट लो प्रेशर, यूजुअली व्हाट इज डन इन दिस केस? इन अ ग्लास बल्ब सम गैस इज फिल्ड एट लो प्रेशर and a high voltage battery is connected with it. So what will happen? The electrons will flow from this terminal A to terminal B. So when this electron they flow from A to B, they will collide with the gas particles filled in this glass bulb. And so the electrons of this gaseous particle they get excited, and so electromagnetic waves, that is radiations, they are emitted from this bulb filled with gas. And if a screen is placed with proper arrangement, then will get the linings on the screen. It is similar to that of a prism. Suppose white light is passed through a prism, then that light get dispersed into its different colors according to different wavelengths. So here also different linings are obtained on the screen according to the wavelength. So here it is written that radiation has a spectrum with which contains certain specific wavelengths. They are obtained on the screen, and this type of emission is called emission line spectrum. So here this spectrum is obtained due to emission of radiations, and so it is known as emission spectra. Students, you can see here on this type of screen, you can see these linings. So this type of linings are obtained. So this type of linings are according to their wavelengths. They specify different wavelengths of the radiations emitted from this gas. Now these radiations which are emitted from the gas, they give such type of line spectra, and this line spectra are the characteristics of the gas. For different gas the line spectra will be different. So students, it is like fingerprint. We know that different persons have different fingerprints. So with the help of fingerprints we can identify the person. Similarly, with the help of line spectra we can identify the gas filled in that glass bulb from which the radiations are emitted. Now absorption spectra. Students, in emission spectra bright lines are obtained, and in absorption spectra on a white screen dark lines are obtained. And how these are obtained? Suppose electromagnetic waves of continuous wavelength they are passed through a bulb filled with low density or low pressure gas. Now this radiations contains wide range of wavelength, and when these radiations they pass through the gas, what happens? Some particular radiations having particular wavelength, means specific wavelength, they are absorbed. This radiations contains wide range of wavelength. So out of that, some particular radiations having particular wavelength, they are absorbed, and rest of the radiations, they fall on the screen. So those radiations which are absorbed by these gases, they are missing on the screen. If there is no bulb, then we will get this all kinds of wavelength on the screen, and it will look bright. But when the bulb is kept in between, what will happen? At some places on the screen, you will find dark lines, and this dark line indicate that that particular radiations having that particular wavelength, they are absorbed by this gas. And so the spectrum obtained on the screen is called absorption spectra. Now students, here this line spectra is obtained for a hydrogen gas. So when the electric current is passed through the hydrogen gas, bright lines are obtained on dark background. When electric current is passed through the gas, what happens? Bright lines are obtained on the dark background, which can be observed using spectrometer. This is an instrument with which we can observe these lines. Now, if the white light is passed, white light is passed through the same gas, that is hydrogen, then what will happen? You will get dark lines on a white background. So here it is written that dark lines are obtained. So in emission spectra, whatever the bright lines are obtained on the dark background, the same thing is observed when the white light is passed through the hydrogen gas. But in that case, in place of white lines, we will observe dark lines on a white background. Now, this spectral series. For hydrogen gas, different types of spectral series are obtained. The first spectral series was observed by scientist Balmer, and he called that series as a Balmer series. This series is in a visible region. Students, we know that in an electromagnetic spectrum, various kinds of electromagnetic waves are emitted, in which only those are observed with eyes which are in a visible region. Other radiations are also there, but they cannot be observed with the help of naked eyes. For that, special arrangement has to be made to observe such lines which are in ultraviolet region or infrared regions. So ultraviolet waves or infrared waves, they cannot be observed with the eyes. They are invisible, we can say. So the first spectral series, which was in a visible region, was studied by Balmer or identified by Balmer, and so that is known as Balmer series. So students, here you can see this is a Balmer series, and this line shows waves with different wavelength. You can see, if we start from right side, then the gap between the two lines, that is gap between the two wavelengths, is large. And as you move from right to left, the difference between the wavelengths of two lines goes on decreasing. You can see the difference goes on decreasing. So this is Balmer series, and you can see here in this, the Balmer series in a visible region is this. So the same part is shown here separately. So this part was observed in visible region, but still this part is also there, even this part is also there in the hydrogen spectra. But this part as well as this part, they are not in a visible region. Only this Balmer series is in a visible region. So that can be observed with the help of naked eyes using spectrometer. So different spectral series are observed in a hydrogen spectra. Now here, even in a Balmer series, different waves with different wavelengths, they are named as H alpha, H beta, H gamma, and so on. So here this H alpha is the first line of hydrogen spectra in Balmer series. Its wavelength is large. Then second line, that is H beta, has wavelength less than this, and you can see the difference is very large between these two. Then third wave, denoted as H gamma, its wavelength is less than this H beta, and you can see now the difference is decreased. So that difference goes on decreasing between the lines. Now to obtain the wavelength and different number of lines, simple empirical formula was given, and this empirical formula is given by 1 upon lambda is equal to r into 1 upon 2 square minus 1 upon n square. Now students, here r is a constant. This r is a constant called Rydberg's constant. Lambda is the wavelength of the wave, and n is a integer, and its value depends on the number of spectral series. Means Balmer series is considered as a second series of hydrogen spectra. So here it is 2 square, because it is second series, so it is 2. So if here it is 2, then here this n will start from 3, 4 and so on. So if we put n is equal to 3 here, then you will get wavelength of this line. If you will put n is equal to 4, then you will get wavelength of this line, and so on. Here that calculation is shown, that Rydberg's constant, its value is 1.09 into 10 raised to 7. If you want to find the wavelength of the first line, that is H alpha, then 2 square as it is, in place of n we have to put 3 for first series. For H alpha it is 3, for H beta it is 4. So here for first line we will put n is equal to 3, and calculating this and obtaining the wavelength, you will get lambda is equal to 656.3 nanometer, and you can see here wavelength is written. For H alpha it is 656.3 nanometer. So students, this was the Balmer series which is observed in a visible region. Now there are other series also which are observed in different regions. The first series is observed in ultraviolet region, that is UV region. And that is Lehmann series. So this is considered, Lehmann series is considered as a first series in a hydrogen spectrum. Then second is Balmer series, which is observed in visible region. which was shown here. Then third series is a Paschen series, which is observed in infrared region. So students, remember, this first series is in UV region. Second series is the Balmer series, which is in visible region. And these three series, Paschen series, Brackett series and Fund series, they are observed in infrared region. Now, Paschen series is observed in near infrared region, because even in the infrared region, it is divided into, it can be divided, infrared region can also be divided into three parts: near infrared region, then infrared region, that is middle infrared region, and far infrared region. So these three series are observed in infrared regions. So students, always remember, which is the first series of hydrogen spectra? Lehmann series. So Lehmann series is the first series. So here in formula you can see it is 1, and if here it is 1, then n will start from 2, 3, 4 and so on. Second series is Balmer series, so it starts with 2, and this n will start from 3, 4, 5 and so on. Then third series is the Paschen series, so it is third series, so here it is 3 square, and so n will start from 4, 5, 6 and then so on. Then Brackett is a fourth series, so here it is 4 square, and then n will start with 5, 6, 7 and so on. Fund series is a fifth spectral series, so here it is 5 square, and so n will start from 6, 7 and so on. So students, if I say which is the first line in a Brackett series, then what we have to do, we have to put here value of n as 5. That will give the first line in a Brackett series. If you want to find second line in a Brackett series, then we have to put n equal to 6. Then we will get the wavelength of the second line in a Brackett series. So formulas are not different, same formula, but we have to simply remember the number of the spectral series, and according to that we have to change these values. Now wavelength is obtained using this type of formula, because here formula is 1 upon lambda is equal to r and so on. Now if we want to find the frequency of that waves or radiation, then we have to use this relation: lambda nu is equal to c. So 1 upon lambda will give you nu by c. So if you want to find the frequency, then in place of 1 upon lambda, we can put this nu by c, where nu is a frequency. This symbol is known as nu, and it is for the frequency. Here this c is the speed of radiations or light or electromagnetic waves in vacuum, and we know that value of c is 3 into 10 raised to 8 meter per second. So in this way we can find the frequency also. So here for Balmer series, the formula for wavelength is this, and if you want to obtain the same relation in terms of frequency, then in place of 1 upon lambda we'll put nu by c, and so making the subject nu we'll get this relation. Now this spectral series is for हाइड्रोजन एटम और हाइड्रोजेनिक एटम। हाइड्रोजन एटम इज अ सिंपलेस्ट एटम। व्हाई इट इज अ सिंपलेस्ट एटम? बिकॉज इन अ हाइड्रोजन देर इज वन प्रोटॉन एंड ओनली वन इलेक्ट्रॉन विच रिवॉल्व्स अराउंड द न्यूक्लियस। सो इट हैज ओनली वन इलेक्ट्रॉन, सो इट्स स्पेक्ट्रम कैन बी ईजीली स्टडीड। सिंपल स्पेक्ट्रम और सिंपल स्पेक्ट्रल सीरीज इज ऑब्टेन। बट फॉर हीलियम, इफ द गैस इज रिप्लेस्ड बाय हीलियम, देन द स्पेक्ट्रल सीरीज इज नॉट दैट मच सिंपल, इट इज कॉम्प्लिकेटेड। बट फॉर हाइड्रोजन लाइक एटम्स वी कैन यूज दिस फॉर्मूलाज। दिस फॉर्मूलाज कैन बी यूज फॉर हाइड्रोजन लाइक एटम। हाइड्रोजन लाइक एटम कैन ऑल्सो बी कॉल्ड एज अ हाइड्रोजेनिक एटम्स। नाउ स्टूडेंट्स, सपोज इफ वी टेक द हीलियम, देन यू नो दैट अराउंड द न्यूक्लियस इन हीलियम देर आर टू इलेक्ट्रॉन्स। सो इफ वी रिमूव वन इलेक्ट्रॉन फ्रॉम द हीलियम, देन दैट हीलियम इज कंसिडर एज आयनाइज्ड एंड इट बिकम एच ई प्लस, बिकॉज वन इलेक्ट्रॉन इज रिमूव्ड, सो इट बिकम एच ई प्लस। सो नाउ वेन वन इलेक्ट्रॉन इज रिमूव्ड, ओनली वन इलेक्ट्रॉन इज लेफ्ट इन द ऑर्बिट। सो एच ई प्लस कंसिस्ट ऑफ ओनली वन इलेक्ट्रॉन इन द ऑर्बिट। सो दिस एच ई प्लस कैन बी कंसिडर्ड एज हाइड्रोजन लाइक एटम और हाइड्रोजेनिक एटम। सो फॉर एच ई प्लस वी कैन ऑप्टेन दिस टाइप ऑफ स्पेक्ट्रम, वी गेट द रिलेशन सिमिलर टू दिस। सिमिलरली लिथियम, इन अ लिथियम एटम अराउंड द न्यूक्लियस देर आर हाउ मेनी इलेक्ट्रॉन्स? थ्री इलेक्ट्रॉन्स दे रिवॉल्व। इन अ लिथियम देर आर थ्री इलेक्ट्रॉन्स। सो सपोज इफ वी रिमूव टू इलेक्ट्रॉन्स, सपोज दिस इलेक्ट्रॉन दिस इलेक्ट्रॉन आर रिमूव्ड, सो दिस लिथियम becomes double ionized, that is it becomes Li2 plus. So when it is double ionized, only one electron is remained in the orbit because two are removed from the lithium. So this Li2 plus can be considered as a hydrogen like atom. And so for this also we can obtain the spectral series. So students, these formulas are used for hydrogen like atom. Now topic number 12.4, Bohr model of the hydrogen atom. Now students, according to Rutherford, electron revolve around the nucleus in a similar way as the planet revolve around the sun. And so Rutherford's model was also considered as a planetary model. Now here we know that electron revolves around the nucleus due to Coulomb's force, and a planet revolving around the sun, that is due to gravitational force. So for planetary motion there is a gravitational force, and for electron moving around the nucleus there will be a Coulomb's force. Now when electron revolve around the nucleus, there is a centripetal force acting on it. You know that when any particle is moving in a circular path, there exists centripetal force. And so, what happens? As the force is acting, there is an acceleration of an electron. So when the electron is revolving around the nucleus, its motion is in general accelerated motion. So according to classical theory, when the electron is having accelerated motion, then an accelerated charged particle must emit radiations. So this electron, which is revolving around the nucleus, should emit electromagnetic waves. And so the energy of this electron should decrease, because when the radiations are emitted, energy of electron should continuously decrease. And so if the energy decreases, then what should happen? The orbit of electron should also decrease. So radius of the orbit should continuously go on decreasing, and continuously the radiations are emitted because of accelerated motion. So this was the classical theory explanation, that there should be a continuous radiations. The spectrum should have continuous spectrum. But actually, we know that the electromagnetic waves which are emitted, they are not having a continuous spectrum. We have studied in that hydrogen spectra that only specific waves are emitted having specific wavelength or frequency. So this type of frequencies or wavelengths are called a discrete frequency or discrete wavelengths. But according to classical theory, all kinds of frequencies or all kinds of wavelengths should be emitted. That means the electromagnetic waves which are emitted should have all types of frequency. That is, it should have a continuous spectrum. And so what should happen? That if electron continuously radiates energy, then its radius decreases continuously. And so the orbit of the electron should not be circular, it should be spiral. And finally, that electron should terminate inside the nucleus. And this shows that the atom cannot remain stable. If this happens, then atom will not remain stable. But we know that atom is actually stable. So Rutherford is unable to explain the stability of atom. So there is a limitation of Rutherford's model. Now that's why here it is written that according to the classical electric theory, the frequency of the electromagnetic waves emitted by the revolving electron is equal to the frequency of the revolution. And as the electron, their path is spiral inwards. Spiral inwards means spiral moving inside towards the nucleus. So electron orbit is spiral inward. The angular velocity of the electron, and so the frequency, that is angular velocity and frequency, should change continuously. Because when the path is spiral, what happens? Its angular velocity will go on increasing. And if the angular velocity increases, then what will happen? The frequency of the radiations which are emitted should also change continuously. And so, according to this classical theory, continuous spectrum should be obtained. But actual spectrum shows that there is no continuous spectrum obtained on the screen. There is a discrete spectrum having discrete frequency or discrete wavelength of the radiations emitted from the hydrogen. So it is clear that the Rutherford model does not explain this thing. It only tells a part of the story, which are not sufficient to explain the structure of an atom. So you can see here, electron, its path should be like this, and finally it should terminate in a nucleus. So Rutherford has some limitations in his model. Now about example number 12.4. According to classical electromagnetic theory, calculate the initial frequency of the light emitted by the electron revolving around the proton in an hydrogen atom. What we want to find here? We want to find the frequency of the light emitted for a hydrogen atom when the electron is revolving around the proton. And what we have to consider here? We have to consider here the classical theory. Now students, calculation is quite simple. We have to consider the data from example 12.3. In example 12.3, which data are given? Let us see. The data is given in 12.3. From this example, we can get the velocity of the electron revolving around the nucleus. Also, we can get the radius of the orbit. So, suppose V is given to us, R is given to us. So, now taking that data here, you can see here radius is 5.3 into 10 raised to minus 11 meter. So this is given to us, and velocity or speed of electron around the hydrogen is 2.2 into 10 raised to minus 6 meter per second. Now students, we know that if an electron completes one revolution around the nucleus, the distance covered for one revolution is suppose d, and time taken for one revolution can be taken as periodic time t. And so we can write speed v is equal to distance upon time. Now, for one revolution, how much distance is covered? If the radius is r, then you know that distance covered for one complete revolution is 2 pi r, that is circumference of this circle. So speed v is equal to distance, that is 2 pi r, and time for one complete rotation is periodic time t. So here this v is a speed. We want to find frequency. Now students, we know that frequency symbol is nu, and frequency is inverse of periodic time. So frequency is 1 by t. Now already we have this equation, that speed v is equal to 2 pi r upon t. So from this equation, we can write that 1 by t is equal to v upon 2 pi r. Simply bring this 2 pi r towards left side. So on right side remained 1 upon t, on left side there will be v upon 2 pi r. But what is this 1 upon t? 1 upon t is nothing but is frequency. So finally, we can say that frequency nu is v, that is speed of electron, upon 2 pi r. So here this direct formula is used. So I hope you understand how this formula is obtained. Now simply put the value of speed 2 pi, pi is 3.14, and radius, radius is given 5.3 into 10 raised to minus 11. So simply put all the values which are given and calculate it. After calculation, you will get frequency is approximately equal to 6.6 into 10 raised to 15 Hertz. So this is the frequency of an electron revolving around the nucleus for an hydrogen atom according to classical theory. So finally, here it is written that according to classical electromagnetic theory, frequency of the electromagnetic waves emitted by the revolving electron is equal to the frequency of the revolution around the nucleus. Means, which type of frequency of radiations are emitted from the hydrogen atom? It will have that frequency with which the electron is revolving around the nucleus. So whatever the frequency of the electron is having, the same frequency should be emitted. So that frequency is obtained as 6.6 into 10 raised to 15 Hertz. So students, I hope you understood about this example. Now students, in spite of certain unanswerable questions related to Rutherford's atomic model, Niels Bohr was convinced about the validity of Rutherford nuclear model. Definitely, the answer about the stability of nucleus was not given by Rutherford's model. Still, Rutherford model is highly valid for the nuclear model or the atomic model. Now, Niels Bohr studied in Rutherford's laboratory for several months so that he can study about the Rutherford's model. Bohr, after studying the Rutherford's model in his laboratory, concluded that in spite of the success of electromagnetic theory in explaining large scale phenomena, it could not be applied to the process at the atomic scale. That means that electromagnetic theory is unable to explain the processes which are occurring at the atomic scale. Now, using the principles of classical mechanics as well as electromagnetism, Bohr gave three postulates. Now, the three postulates of Bohr's are given here. His first postulate says that an electron in an atom could revolve in certain stable orbit without the emission of radiant energy. Means, in an atom, electron can revolve in such orbit where there is no emission of electromagnetic radiations, and that orbit for electron can be considered as a stable orbit. So electron can revolve in a stable orbit without emission of any radiation. So that was the first postulate given by Bohr. Now, second postulate. According to second postulate, electron revolve around the nucleus only in those orbits for which angular momentum is some integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. Means, electron can revolve in such orbits where the angular momentum is conserved, and it is conserved as well as that angular momentum should be integer multiple of h upon 2 pi. So Bohr gave this second postulate, that angular momentum is the integer multiple of h upon 2 pi. Now students, here this h is a Planck's constant, as we know, and n can be considered as a quantum number. It is an integer. Its value is 1, 2, 3 and so on. So here we can say that the angular momentum is quantized. Students, quantization of charge we have studied in first chapter. That total charge Q is the integer multiple of E. Similarly, the angular momentum N is the integer multiple of H upon 2 pi. So we can say that even angular momentum is quantized. Then, third postulate given by Bohr. This postulate is related to energy. Now, Bohr's third postulate incorporated into atomic theory to early quantum concepts that had been developed by Planck and Einstein. So, third postulate was based on Planck and the Einstein theory. According to this third postulate, when an electron make a transition from one stable orbit to another stable orbit, suppose electron is at some higher stable orbit, and when it is moved to another stable orbit which is lower orbit, then the radiation is emitted, and this radiation has certain energy, and that energy is nothing but it is the difference of the energy of initial orbit to the final orbit. Suppose energy of the electron in this orbit is EI, and energy of electron in this orbit is EF. So when electron makes transition from this outer orbit to inner orbit, that is from higher orbit to lower orbit, then the radiations are emitted, and that radiation has the energy which is equal to the difference of these two energies, and the frequency is related to that energy difference, because we know that energy E is equal to h nu. So a particular radiation with that particular frequency or wavelength is emitted. So this is the third postulate of Bohr. Now students, about the radius of the nth orbit. This is an important theory. We want to obtain the formula for the radius of the electron orbit. And you know that electron can revolve in different orbits. So we will obtain the radius of nth orbit of an electron around the nucleus in an hydrogen atom. So now let us start with Bohr's second postulate. We know that Bohr's second postulate says that L is equal to N into H upon 2 pi. Also, angular momentum for a particle moving in a circular path can be given by L is equal to mvr. So comparing this to angular momentums, we can write angular momentum in nth orbit ln is equal to m vn rn. You can see here L is equal to mvr. So for nth orbit, velocity will be vn and radius will be rn. Here this n represents the number of orbit and m is the mass of electron which is revolving around the nucleus. And so ln is equal to nh upon 2 pi. So we have compared these two. Now students, to obtain the velocity of an electron, we have to use the earlier relation. Let me show you. We have earlier seen that the electric force, that is Coulombian force, is equal to centripetal force for an electron revolving around the nucleus. So from this equation, if we make the subject v square, then we will get v square is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught into r. Here you can see both the side, there are 1 r will cancel, so 1 r is remained, so that is written here e square, and this m will be here. So we will get v square is equal to this equation, and so taking square root on both the side, we will get velocity in nth orbit as vn is equal to e upon square root of 4 pi epsilon naught m rn. Here simply subscript n is used for nth orbit. N is a quantum number which represents the number of orbit. So this equation is obtained from equation number 12.3. So you have to show that method of obtaining v. Now using equation number 12.13, in this equation you can see here this equation is equation number 12.13. So you have to use this equation here in this equation, and with little simplification, making the subject vn, you will get this relation. So you will get the speed in the nth orbit of an electron. So students, you have to do some mathematical step for this. I hope you will be able to do that. In a similar way, you can also obtain the equation for radius of nth orbit. So little simplification is required to obtain these equations. Now students, orbital speed in nth orbit falls by a factor of n. You can see the equation is in terms of n. So the size of the innermost orbit, that is lowest orbit, can be obtained by putting n is equal to 1. So if you put n is equal to 1 in this equation, then you will get the innermost orbit. So you will get r1 is equal to h square epsilon naught pi me square. Now students, here you can see that these two equations are not different, same only. You have to simply put n is equal to 1. The rest of the thing you have to simply simplify and you will get this. So here just put in this equation, put n is equal to 1 and simplify it to get this equation. So this is the radius of the
इनर मोस्ट ऑर्बिट, दैट इज फॉर एन इज इक्वल टू वन. सो बोहर कॉल्ड दिस रेडियस एज बोहर्स रेडियस एंड सिंबल फॉर दिस आर वन इज नाउ टेकन एज ए नॉट. एंड सो सेम थिंग इज रिप्रेजेंटेड हियर बट इन प्लेस ऑफ आर वन ए नॉट इज रिटन and it is called the Bohr's radius. Now students, here these values you can see here on right hand side all are constants. H is a Planck's constant, pi, mass of electron, charge of an electron, epsilon naught, all these are the constants. So putting these constant values and calculating, you will get the radius of innermost orbit, that is Bohr's radius, to be equal to 5.29 into 10 raised to minus 11 meter. So here we obtained the equation of radius. Now energy of nth orbit for an electron revolving around the nucleus in different orbits, it has energy in that orbit. So to find the equation of energy, simply what you have to do, you have to use the value of r. Whatever the value of r n is obtained here, that you have to use in the equation of energy. So students, equation number 12.15 is nothing but it is the equation of radius in nth orbit. So that you have to use in equation number 12.4, which we have obtained earlier. Let me show you 12.4. So the total energy of an electron is given by this equation. You can say 12.4 equation. So in this equation, simply you have to write in terms of n. So En is equal to minus E square upon 8 pi epsilon naught and R n. So in this equation, we have to use the value of R n. And so using that you will get this equation. Simplifying this, we will get En is equal to minus m e raised to 4 8 upon 8 n square epsilon naught square h square. So this is the equation of energy in nth orbit. Now students, again these values on the right hand side are constants. If you will put these values, you will get energy in nth orbit as minus 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 upon n square in joule. So if you want to find energy in the first orbit, that is in the innermost orbit, then you have to put this n is equal to 1. So if you put this n is equal to 1, then you will get the energy of the innermost orbit, energy of electron in innermost orbit, and that will be definitely equal to 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 joule, because when you put n is equal to 1, then you will get this value for innermost orbit. Now students, this is energy in terms of joule. If you want this energy in terms of electron volt, then simply divide this value which is in the joule by 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19. So joule will be converted to electron volt. And so in electron volt, the energy is minus 13.6 upon n square electron volt. So if I ask you, what is the energy in electron volt in the lowermost orbit, that is in the innermost orbit, then just put n is equal to 1. So you'll get energy in the first orbit is equal to minus 13.6 electron volt. So students, I hope you understood about how the equation of radius as well as equation of energy can be obtained. So this topic is quite important for the examination point of view. Now example number 12.5. Given that a satellite of 10 kg mass circles the planet every 2 hours, that is periodic time is 2 hours and mass is m. Radius of the orbit of this satellite r is 8000 km. So here for this satellite we have to assume the Bohr's angular momentum postulate, and considering this Bohr's angular momentum postulate we have to find the quantum number of the orbit of this satellite. Quantum number means n, so n is question mark. Students, we know that around the nucleus electron can revolve in different orbits. For different orbits n is different. For innermost orbit n is equal to 1, then for second orbit n is equal to 2. So these are nothing but these are the quantum numbers of the orbit. So similarly here for a satellite, for its given conditions we have to find its quantum number. Now solution for this example. Here for a satellite mass is given, periodic time of revolution is given, radius of the orbit is given, and we need to find the quantum number n using Bohr's postulate. So students, according to Bohr's postulate we know that angular momentum n is nh upon 2 pi. Let us give this equation number 1. Also for a particle moving in a circular path its angular momentum is given by L is equal to mvr. So combining these two equation or comparing these two equation we will get mvr is equal to nh upon 2 pi. So we got this after comparison. Now simply make this n subject. So if we make this n subject we will get 2 pi r mv upon h. Now let us give this equation number 3. Students, remember here v is not given. So now for that we know that speed is distance upon time. Now when this satellite completes one revolution, distance covered is 2 pi r, where r is the radius, and for one revolution time taken is periodic time t. So we can write speed v is equal to distance, which is 2 pi r, and time for one revolution is periodic time t. Let us give this equation number 4. Now using this equation number 4, that is value of v here in equation number 3, we will get n is equal to 2 pi r square m upon h into t. Now students, h is a Planck's constant, mass is given, r is given. So just put all those values which are given. Look here, 2, value of pi 3.14, radius is given 8000 km. So convert this 8000 km into meter, so we'll get 8 × 10⁶ meter and square. Mass is given 10 kg, Planck's constant 6.64 into 10 raised to minus 34, and periodic time given 2 hours. So we have to convert this hour into seconds. So 2 into 1 hour is equal to 3600 second. So periodic time t is 2 into 3600. Now calculating these values, we will get n is equal to 5.3 into 10 raised to 45. So this is the quantum number for a satellite revolving around the planet, and this quantum number is extremely large for a given satellite. So such quantization condition tend to those of classical physics, means it is related to the classical physics or classical mechanics calculation. Now about energy levels of electron in an hydrogen atom. Students, in this figure you can see that the electron in a ground state, that is electron revolving in its innermost orbit, that is lowest orbit, has the energy minus 13.6. In second orbit, that is for n is equal to 2, it has energy minus 3.4, and so on for third, fourth and fifth orbits. These are the energies. Now students, here first orbit, that is innermost orbit, is considered as a ground state of an electron, and rest of the orbits, they are known as excited state. So here n is equal to 2 means it is the first excited state, n is equal to 3 is the second excited state. Now students, if the energy is supplied to this electron which is in a ground state, then that electron can move to the next orbit. Now here you can see the energy difference between n is equal to 1 and n is equal to 2 is how much. So here it is shown that the difference of the energy for n is equal to 1 and n is equal to 2 is 10.2 electron volt. That means if an electron is gaining the energy of about 10.2 electron volt, then it will move from the ground state to this first excited state, that is n is equal to 2. Similarly, you can see the energy difference between n is equal to 3 and n is equal to 1 is how much. It is 12.09 electron volt. That means if the electron which is in the ground state is given energy equal to 12.09 electron volt, then it will move from the ground state to second excited state, which is n is equal to 3. Now imagine that the electron which is in the ground state, which is having energy minus 13.6 electron volt, and if we give energy equal to plus 13.6 electron volt to this electron which is in the ground state, then what will happen? The total energy will become zero, because it is having the energy minus 13.6, and if we supply same amount of energy, then total energy of the electron will become zero. Then in that case, what will happen? That electron will move out of the atom, means we can say that that atom gets ionized, and so the energy becomes zero. So to ionize the atom, we have to supply the energy equal to that which is the energy in that orbit. So if the electron is in the first orbit, then if we supply that much energy, then it will get ionized. Suppose the electron is already in the n is equal to 2 orbit, that is in the first excited state. And if we want to ionize that atom, then we have to supply this much energy only. That means plus 3.4. So if this much energy is supplied to the electron which is in the first excited state, then it get ionized. So energy supplied to an electron so that the atom gets ionized, that energy supplied is known as ionization energy. So here students, in this figure, different energy states of an electron in a hydrogen atom are given. Finally, for n is equal to infinite, infinite means now electron is not bound, it is in a free state, it is not bound to the nucleus. So for that n is equal to infinite, and in that case the electron will have energy 0 electron volt. And once again, for n is equal to infinite, radius r will also be infinite. So this 0 electron volt is the highest energy state, because rest of the energies are in negative. Rest of the energy, you can see it is negative. Negative energy shows that electron is still bound to the nucleus. And if the energy is 0, means that electron is now in free state, means it is not bound to the nucleus. So 0 can be considered as the highest energy state. So I hope you understood about the energy levels of electron in an hydrogen atom.